Hi everybody, very pleased to report on the planetary mission concept study about Ceres. I will tag team with John Brophy, who is the study lead at JPL. So first I wanted to introduce and thank the study team. You have the list of co-investigators on the left, and I'm going quick. Just a nice chart. I wanted to acknowledge the very excellent support that we've got from John's study team, as well as the program formulation office at JPL. We also benefited from a lot of collaborators and contributors who've been very responsive to our requests for information. Also wanted to acknowledge the contributions from private companies, Honeybee Robotics, Lockheed Martin, and DSS, who've been very keen on sharing information on their products. And lastly, I would like to thank NASA for the opportunity to have us do this study. I really like the format. I really like the fact that we could have a science team working together and working with the study team at JPL. I thought that was a very good format. And especially wanted to thank Mike from NASA, who has been following our study very closely. So, this concept, it follows directly in the tracks from the Dawn mission. We are basically in the last stage of publishing the main results from the mission, with a special issue coming up in the summer. And Dawn revealed Ceres to be an astrobiological target and an evolved ocean world. So Dawn had a bunch of investigations, infrared spectroscopy, imaging, gravity science, and elemental spectroscopy. And the geophysical data revealed that Ceres is differentiated into volatile rich crust, rocky mantle of very low, relatively low density with a lot of porosity, and a weak layer between the two, which we explain by the presence of a little bit of liquid, and there is additional evidence for this that I'm going to present. The surface of Ceres is shaped by water ice. It's very clear in about all the features that we find on the surface. We see glaciers, pingos, and we find a lot of commonalities with icy moons, for example, in crater morphology. Dawn also revealed salts all over the surface of Ceres, and the composition could be determined with the infrared spectrometer. And reveal an alkaline environment as a source for these salts, and which is very important. We found composition that is akin to what Cassini found at Enceladus. Dawn also found organic matter in concentrated in a crater that's called Ernoutet, but also found carbon compounds all over the surface with up to 28% of carbon in the regolith. And now talking about more about the energy and geological evolution, there are a few features on the surface that are relatively young, less than 100 million years, and are expression of volcanism and exchange between the surface and between the interior and the surface, sorry. And one of them is Haona Mons, which is this huge 4 kilometer tall mountain, which is rich in sodium carbonate. And Cerealia facula, and the facula in Okator crater, which display activity that may be as young as 0 million years old. Basically, activity could be ongoing. And this suggests there could be liquid directly below, at least Okator crater at present. So to put the Dawn results in context and present the motivation for the concepts presented today, here is some comparison between Ceres and other icy moons for situational awareness. So Ceres is about 1,000 kilometers across. It's about twice the size of Enceladus. And first a striking observation is that its mantle density is about the same density as Enceladus. And it's been suggested that in objects that are relatively small, like Ceres and Enceladus, rocky mantle can preserve a lot of porosity, either in the form of the convecting mud or enormous fracturation in the mantle. And so that is an important commonality between Ceres and Enceladus. Ceres also has a thick shell, probably very little liquid left at present. And that's a commonality it shares with Callisto, which has also been suggested to be nearing its the end of its life as an ocean world. And that's emerging work by Steve Vance and his team. And Ceres display alkaline chemistry, as I said, similar to what has been found at Enceladus. And a future mission would reveal the full chemical inventory in order to draw conclusions about the habitability of that type of planetary environment. The recent evidence for brine effusion at Ceres, it requires a mechanism for preserving liquid until present. And the pre-dawn geophysical models predicted that there could be liquid in Ceres at present, just because Ceres is close to the sun, so it's relatively warm, and salts decrease the eutectic, and that would be an explanation for the preservation of brine. But something that was not predicted by pre-dawn models is that there would actually be activity ongoing at present on Ceres. And so that sets a new spin for understanding the long-lived activity at other icy bodies that are deprived of tidal heating, like Pluto and Callisto. As noted, the presence of a relatively muddy, briny layer in the interior is a commonality with Enceladus, and it presents a medium that is favorable for prebiotic chemistry. So that is another motivation for exploring Ceres and better understand the state of evolution of the organics on its surface. And lastly, Dawn found ammonia, evidence for ammonia and a lot of carbon dioxide in the form of carbonates on the surface of Ceres. And that suggests that the Ceres' volatiles came from the outer solar system, and there might be a genetic connection with the icy moons of the giant planets. So when we started the study, we wanted to explore everything. We wanted to go to at least these four sites, rich in organics in the case of Ernoutek crater. Howlandy crater is a young impact crater that exposes fresh material from the crust. So we wanted to explore it in order to understand Ceres's early habitability trapped in the crust. We wanted to explore Honeymoon because it's a very cool feature, and we wanted to explore Okator crater because of the recent and potentially ongoing activity. But what we found out by working with John and his team is that hopping from one site to another is theoretically it's easy, but it requires a lot of propellant. And very early in the study, it became clear that we cannot do 100 kilometer hops. You just spent your entire mass in the form of propellant. So we had to pick a site, and we had very interesting discussions about that. First, we came to the conclusion that the organic matter found in Ernoutek crater, it's not clear whether or not it's from Ceres. It's still debated that maybe it could have been supplied by a cometary impact. And there was a science risk by visiting that particular place. So we discarded that site, valuable. In the case of Honeymoon, there was really no way to access the material. And so it's too bad, but we had to discard that site for implementation reasons. Howlandy crater was our second best target site of interest, but it's really Okator with its ongoing, potentially ongoing activities that was identified as a top science priority for future exploration of Ceres. So just to give you some context, this is a cross-section of the subsurface at Okator crater based on the results from the Dawn second extended mission. Okator is less than 20 million years. It has some very recent, I would say, ongoing material exposure probably. And we thought that an impact melt chamber created by impact heating would be a way to keep activity going for a long time, I mean, for at least 18 million years. But even by pushing the models, we came to the conclusion that we need a secondary source. We need a long-lived source of brine in order to explain the activity. This combined with other geological observation, we came to the conclusion that the brine at Okator is sourced from a deep brine layer. And so my cursor is frozen. The deep brine layer is here, and we have fractures supplying material to the surface of Okator. So the goals of our concept is to, the goals, sorry, are to first assess the current habitability of Ceres, and in order to use Ceres as a test case for better understanding the habitability of icy bodies through time. And we have a second goal, which is to determine the origin of Ceres and use that information to constrain the flux of volatiles and organics in the early solar system and supply of volatiles and organics to the inner solar system. In terms of the objectives are framed in a way to progress along the roadmap for Ocean World, which is a product from a study that was led by Amanda Hendricks and Terry Herford a few years ago. And it describes the type of information that we would want to learn at Ocean Worlds in order to better understand their habitability and prospect for life emergence. And so rapidly I've summarized what we've learned from the Dawn mission about Ceres in the context of the of this roadmap. We know for sure that there are ocean signatures, that there is some energy sources, but it's not clear exactly what the source is. We know there is the rock ocean interface, but we don't know exactly at what depth. And we know there is evidence for surface access, but we need to get a better understanding of how far it's been ongoing. And what we're proposing here is two concepts, and I will describe both, an in-situ exploration concept and the sample return concept. And this is just a sneak peek of what we expect to learn at Ceres with these two concepts. And so we, especially with the sample return concept, which I will focus on, we expect to really retire, to progress very significantly along this roadmap. So the first objective of this study of future exploration of Ceres is to test if intrusions from the Mandimental have operated throughout Ceres' history. As noted, there is geophysical evidence for a few landmarks, geological landmarks that are sourced from below the crust. But there are many other domes found on the surface of Ceres, and that appear to be of cryovolcanic origin, and that is work from our study co-I, Michael Sorry. Way to address the source of these features is to perform high resolution gravity combined with geological imaging from orbit at a few sites of interest. And an example is Koseka Tholus and Haulani crater. And this will help quantify the transfer of material from the mantle to the surface through space and time. And this is important because this transfer of material can create locally a chemical disequilibrium, which is a potential source of energy for life forms. And more generally, what we learn at Ceres can be applied to other icy bodies. A second objective is to test if activity is ongoing at present at Okator crater. It's very simple investigation. If we go back to Ceres in about 20 years, we expect at least 100 square meter new material exposed in Okator crater based on the modeling from the study co-I Linequick. And so we would search for new exposure of material in the visible, also in color. I don't know if you can see well the color on your screens. The fresh material appear to have a pinkish color. Oh, sorry. And so it's the reason why we want to perform color imaging from orbit at a resolution that is at least that obtained by Dawn in its second extended mission. Ongoing activity at Ceres would be really a major results and would support the hypothesis that bodies that are heat starved, that don't have, for example, tidal heating, can get long-lived activity, probably driven by brines. The third objective is to determine the depth of liquid below Okator. So we know there are brines, but as you can see on this sketch from James Keane for one of our upcoming papers, it's a complex story. There is some sealing for the brine mud, but there are also cracks and fractures that supply the material to the surface, and we would like to get a better understanding of this configuration below Okator crater. We've been looking at various types of geophysical investigations, and we came to the conclusion that magnetotelluric sanding is a very promising technique, and we worked with Bob Grimm from Swery, who demonstrated that indeed it would be a good technique to at least find the depth of the brine mud and potentially detect brine pockets that are shallower. Getting an idea of the brine configuration below Okator crater would set a very strong constraint on the temperature profile in the crust, and that can then help when you apply that information to the rest of Ceres, you can then get a better understanding of the evolution of Ceres and understand over features on the surface, and especially the surface-subsurface material exchange. Now I'm going to focus more on chemical observations. And the first one is to characterize the deep brine environment below Okator crater by performing chemical observations of the faculae material here. The good thing is that because this material has been recently exposed, it has not been degraded or very little by space weathering. It's not been contaminated by mixing with micrometeorites, for example. And so we looked at two ways to address this objective. And one is to send state-of-the-art in situ instruments. And we found a Stroman payload that would address the question of environmental properties at these evaporites in detail by having a Raman spectrometer or a mass spectrometer and elemental spectroscopy and tunable laser spectroscopy. But we also considered the possibility that if we return evaporite material back to Earth, of course, we benefit from all the panoply of measurements in Earth grade, in Earth facilities, and that is very appealing. And of course, by studying the evaporite Okator, we get better insights into the chemical evolution of icy moons, in particular Enceladus, and we can address many other questions, like, for example, whether chemical energy is still available in the brines below Okator crater. Objective 5 focuses on the evolution of organic matter in the brine reservoir below Okator. So we know we have a lot of carbon on the surface. We don't see directly organic matter inside Okator crater, but we think that it's there, just not been resolved by the Dawn mission. And especially, we believe that there is organic matter trapped in the evaporites. It's very frequent on Earth to have organic matter trapped in salts. And our co-I, Max Zolensky, is part of a team that has found class of salts in the meteorite record, and these class have organic matter and other inclusions, like fluid inclusions. So in this case, we looked at what instruments could give us information about more information and understanding of the evolution of organic compounds on Ceres. And we came to the conclusion that state-of-the-art instruments would not be capable of resolving organic matter trapped in the salts, and that really in this case a sample return would be required in order to better address the question of organic science at Ceres. And the significance of this investigation is enormous. In particular, we would like to get a better understanding of the relationship between the carbonates and the organics, because we see a lot of carbonates, the geological landmarks on the surface that stem from the deep brine reservoir are dominated by carbonates, and we don't see any organics there. And there is a possibility that it's because the organic matter is being oxidized. And so we want to address this question in more detail. And more generally, this investigation would document the fate of organic matter in long-lived ocean worlds. Lastly, objective six is about determining the origin of Ceres. And so we know that the volatiles on Ceres can come from the outer solar system, but the exact origin and formation mechanism is not understood. The best way to address this question is via isotopes of volatiles and elemental studies. But the problem is that if you send a mission to the surface, there is only a limited number of elements that can be, and isotopes that can be investigated. And we know that the breakthrough in terms of origin science come from studying elements that cannot be detected with the current state of instrumentation at Ceres, like oxygen 17, isotopes of chromium and other minor elements. Furthermore, origin science, it's a field that is always evolving, and we thought that the best way to address origins at Ceres is to return a sample to be studied for future decades in Earth-grade facilities. And the significance of this is obvious. If we understand the origin of Ceres, we can put in context the evolution of the solar system and the origin of organics and volatiles on Earth. So in summary, that's the trade space we had proposed to study. In the proposal, we wanted to have orbiters, various types of landers. We traded a lot of payload, and we traded multiple ways to accomplish sample return. And I'm going fast because what matters is the outcome of this trade space analysis. We ended up with two concepts. Both include an orbital phase. One concept has a mobile lander that has a large scale, tens of kilometer capability in order to study two sites at Okator crater, and one is a static lander that can perform a sample return. In both cases, we need an orbital phase in order to address the activity, global and ongoing activity objectives. In both cases, we have a magnetotelluric sending experiment after the orbiter lands on the surface of Ceres in order to look for liquid. In the case of the mobile lander, we settled on the Strowman payload, tunable laser spectroscopy, Raman spectroscopy, and elemental spectroscopy. But as noted, it became clear that there is high science risk or partial success with addressing the organic science and origin science objectives. On the other hand, in our second concept, which became the focus of the second phase of the study, we perform sample return and we can address these objective 4 to 6 very well. Both concepts are based on a single element spacecraft, and that is because Ceres is close to Earth and its relativity is relatively low, so you can land and take off for relatively little propellant. And both concepts, they fit within the New Frontiers cost cap following the guidelines provided by NASA, so including the 50% cost reserve. We concluded that sample return from an ocean world is the most appealing concept in terms of science return per dollar, plus the mission would accomplish critical science in orbit and in situ prior to bringing back the sample. The in situ concept was also very exciting because we can jump to two sites. And you know, that's just exciting to have a hopper on Ceres. And it's not our prime concept because of the science risk, but it will also be documented in the report. And that is where we are going. Vinalia Facula exposes, Vinalia Facula is on the eastern part of Okator crater here. It exposes young evaporites. We want to sample both bright and dark materials associated with vents So here is an example of vents and fractures that have been found by Biden. In this region, we will image the landing site at 30 centimeters per pixel, and our landing site expert on the team, Jennifer Scully, has demonstrated that based on the done data at about 5 meters per pixel, there are a bunch of areas that could be accessible by a future lander. And we would use the Pneumavax system from Honeybee Robotics that can sample loose material, but with drilling capability as a backup. And we know the material is relatively loose. You see there are ballistic emplacement, helicoidal feature here, for example. And we're aiming for about 100 grams of material acquired from 3 feet. Briefly, the Strowman payload for the sample return concept is to have a narrow angle camera, and we took the Lunar Reconnaissance Orbiter camera as an example because it has time delay integration, which is needed in order to deal with the relative fast velocity at Ceres. It meets our landing site certification requirements from 30 kilometer altitude. And we bring two. One is for block redundancy. Once on the surface, we will perform a characterization of the material with a near IR point spectrometer, at least to assess the state of hydration of the material, because we know it's going to be degraded during the trip back to Earth, and we are using a new product from JBL. And lastly, we are carrying a magnetotellurium. A telluric sanding package developed by Bob Grimm at Swery, and we know, and Bob already computed, that we need tens of hours of integration time in order to meet our brine detection requirements. Sorry, so I'm John, it's for you.
All right, thanks, Julie. It's clear that Ceres is a really interesting place to go to or go back to, and then so the question is, how do we get there? How do we get there and back? We looked at a lot of different mission designs and different architectures to try to get there, to get down to the surface, and for the sample returns to get back. And it's not surprising and quite clear that for a sample return from Ceres that you need for the heliocentric transfer part, not only solar electric propulsion, but the gridded ion version of electric propulsion, similar to what Dawn used, except at a higher power level. We looked at solid rocket motors, monoprop systems, biprop systems, deep space maneuvers, all sorts of different combinations. But for the sample return, got to have solar electric propulsion with gridded ion thrusters. The total delta V is like 14 kilometers per second. So that's significantly more, actually, than the 11.5 kilometers per second that Dawn used. This is an example of what the trajectory looks like. This assumes a 2033 launch, although with this system, you really have launch opportunities essentially every year in the 2030s. And the performance doesn't vary strongly with launch year. This, as you might imagine, takes a fair amount of propellant, about 1,200 kilograms of xenon, and interestingly enough, about the same amount of hydrazine, which is used to land on Ceres and then take back off again. The outbound trip is about 6.5 years. In this example, there is a Mars gravity flyby. That outbound trip is longer than you might imagine, primarily because we're pushing a lot of propellant, all the way to Ceres. The return trip is shorter, and of course, the sample return is a direct entry back at Earth. This assumes the Option 4 launch vehicle, which is the high-performance version. The performance is equivalent to a reusable version of the Falcon Heavy launch vehicle. The round trip trajectory takes almost 13 years, but that includes a 500 day stay time at Ceres. All right, next chart. So we created a configuration for the flight system, and we did that so that we could generate a detailed MEL that we could then use to cost the the vehicle and the overall mission. And this is what the vehicle looks like. It's relatively large. It's about 4 meters tall. And when the solar arrays are deployed, it's about 26 meters wingtip to wingtip. You can see there are three gridded ion thrusters of the ones that NASA is developing called NEXT. That's NASA's evolutionary xenon thruster. And there's one big xenon tank in the middle and three large hydrazine tanks around the outside. We put all the heavy stuff at the bottom. There are the landing legs here are not deployable. They're fixed and they're sized so that they just fit inside the dynamic envelope of a 5 meter fairing. Each leg has the Pneumovac sampling system from Honeybee Robotics, and that delivers the samples directly to the sample return capsule shown on the backside there. The solar arrays are shown inclined here in the stowed position, and that is so it gives us an extra degree of articulation. For the heliocentric crews, they're deployed outwards. And so they're perpendicular to the vertical axis here, but when we're on the surface, we can actually articulate them back so that when we deploy them on the surface, that helps avoid obstacles if there are any. The landing thrusters are at the bottom, and you see our average person off the street kind of for scale there over on the right side. Next chart. So this is what it looks like in the cruise configuration. Kind of looks upside down here, but we put the ion thrusters there at the bottom. The solar array is sized in this example for 27.5 kilowatts at 1 AU, beginning of life. You know, with electric propulsion, there's a big trade space for how much power and trip time and propellant and specific impulse. And so this is an example. It's not a unique solution by any means, but it's a reasonable approach to getting there and back. We run two of the gridded ion thrusters at a time. Oh, if you can go back. And let's see. So planetary protection obviously is a big deal, and that assessment is still in progress here. Okay, now we'll go to the next chart. The nice thing about electric propulsion here for this application is you go into orbit first, you get that basically for free, and that allows us to characterize the landing site, as Julie mentioned, and we can characterize that to about 30 centimeters per pixel. And that's really important because then it allows us to identify and choose safe landing sites. And we do that from orbit so that we know that we're going to go to both a scientifically interesting and safe location where we want to land in Akator Crater. And then we can go there. We build up maps that we generate from these images from orbit, and we use an enhanced landing vision system based on the Mars 2020 system so that we can use terrain relative navigation and navigate to a very precise landing site. And so we're quite confident that we can find these relatively small 10 meter sized landing areas that are safe for the vehicle to land in and also scientifically interesting. To do that, we stow the solar arrays. And the solar array technology that we've assumed here is based on the rollout solar array from deployable space systems. And they demonstrated on the International Space Station a few years ago, the ability to deploy and retract the array. So we retract the array to land. Once we're on the surface, we redeploy it so that we have plenty of power and time to obtain the samples and do the science investigation on the surface, verify that we have the samples. And then we restow the array, take off, go back into orbit at Ceres, deploy the array once more for the heliocentric trip back to Earth, and then drop the sample return capsule off for direct entry back at Earth. And the sample return capsules would be designed to maintain the samples at or below minus 20 degrees C for the return trip. All right, I think that is it. Thanks.
And so to conclude, CRS is a very compelling target for new frontiers. The simple return concept that we presented, as well as in situ concepts, are feasible with existing NASA-funded technology. Total flight time is about 13 years, but with three objectives can be achieved in orbit and in situ before bringing back the sample. And returning a sample, you know, it's fantastic. It would benefit from decade-long analysis and will inform oceanward evolution. And I'm just leaving this chart to put the sample return concept in context of the current landscape for planetary exploration. Sample return of organics and volatiles would retire important gaps about the origin of habitable worlds in the inner solar system and put the other sample returns in context. And of course, it will bring invaluable information about the evolution of ocean worlds. Thanks.
Okay, thanks, Julie and John. We did receive some questions, and it looks like we've got several minutes in which to answer those. First of all, why is Ceres thought to be an ocean world?
Okay, so I go back to the beginning. So Ceres is a potential, okay, it's going to take a while to get there, potential ocean world in the roadmap for ocean world based on the results from the Dawn mission. And it's really based on a combination of observations. One is that there is a lot of water on Ceres, about 25% of water. And we know there is a crust of ice and hydrates at present. There is also evidence for salts all over the surface, and there is evidence for liquid at present, at least below some regions, and especially Okator crater.
Okay. Another question. Does the hydrazine used for landing damage the samples for the search for organics?
Yeah, so I can take that on. That's a very good question. We looked at that a lot, and it's clear that there is going to be some contamination. But when we bring back a sample, it will be possible to tease out the hydrazine, the elements from the hydrazine from the elements that belong to Ceres, and it will be possible to desorb the hydrazine from the material. And so that's another big advantage of bringing back the sample.
Okay, let's see. It looks like we've still got about 5 minutes. Question perhaps for John, why not use RTGs instead of solar panels, thereby eliminating the need to deploy and retract solar arrays?
Yeah, so we considered that, and so I'll answer that in two ways. One is the approach that we selected here, where we deploy and retract the arrays, is not the only solar-powered solution. There are other approaches where you manage the large arrays in a different way. You may articulate them, you know, perhaps above your head or so to manage the deal with them during the landing and takeoff processes. So you're not necessarily locked into the rollout solar array technology to do that. And the other thing is that, you know, the reason we were trying to focus on a solar powered mission is that Ceres is, you know, only at about 3 AU, and so there's still plenty of sunlight available to do that. So we were motivated to look for a non-nuclear solution to that. That doesn't mean you couldn't do it with the RTGs, but then you have to, that ripples back into the rest of the architecture and how you get there. So if you have, the RTGs may help you on the surface, but doesn't help you in the transportation to and from. And so you might still need large solar arrays, and so you have to pay for those anyway.
All right, thanks, John. Jayadev at ISRO asks, as I understand, Ceres shows indications of a tenuous water vapor atmosphere, probably from outgassed water ice. Since this would be crucial for habitability studies of the body, are there any proposals for a study of the tenuous atmosphere?
So that's another very good question. We looked at this, one of our objectives in the proposal was to look at that. The thing is that the atmosphere is very tenuous. It's not clear that it is there, actually. And if there is some atmosphere, it's probably due to some exosphere, it's due to sublimation. But there is not enough ice on the surface to explain past observations, which I think the question is about. There was outgassing detected about 10 years ago, but you know, when Ceres got there, when Don got to Ceres, Don did not find any evidence for an atmosphere or source of gas from Ceres, of water vapor. So we thought there would be a science risk in focusing an investigation on this aspect.
Okay, thanks, Julie. We have about 2 minutes, probably time for one last question here. Suniti at LSU asks, in what ways would observations at targets like Akatorn and Ahuna be used to clarify connections between mapped geologic units and ground-based regional geochemical variations?
Definitely if we return a sample from Okator crater, we will have definitive evidence for composition of the bright material, but what matters especially for Grant is what's also going on in the darker material. And we will know, for example, how much carbon is in the dark material, and that would be an important point of reference for the Grant data.